All right, let's discuss the cranial base. And specifically, we're going to look at a superior view of the cranial base. So what had to be removed in order for us to be able to see this? Your skull cap or your calvaria. So those important bones that are protecting the brain, we removed those superiorly, and now we're looking inside where the brain would sit typically. And as you can see, it's in a very characteristic stair-step appearance. You're going to have the anterior cranial fossa, which is the highest, the middle cranial fossa, and then the deepest and the most, the largest area is going to be the posterior cranial fossa, because not only is the occipital lobe of the cerebrum sitting there, but also the cerebellum. So we'll discuss each one in order, and then we'll talk about the pertinent cranial nerves that are actually exiting this region. So let's start with the anterior cranial fossa. This is going to extend from the squama of your frontal bone all the way to the posterior portion of the lesser wing of the sphenoid. So you can see very wing-like in appearance of the sphenoid bone. And the sphenoid is this large complex right here. We'll discuss a lot more in terms of the foramina here, but it's also going to be this posterior border. Now, your frontal lobe of the cerebrum sits right in this region. And the frontal lobe, when you're talking about Homo sapiens, very well developed in comparison to other mammals. So that's why we have such a large area right here. It's also why we have such a substantial forehead in comparison to other mammals. So very well developed. But in terms of the foramina in this region, not quite as complex. So where we're going to discuss right now is right here in the midline. You can see this place right here referred to as the cribriform plate. And within that cribriform plate, you're going to have these tiny little dots. You're going to have numerous foramina, cribriform foramina, where olfactory axons are actually coalescing to form the olfactory nerves. So think olfactory. What does that stand for? Olfaction, which has to do with smell. So this is your cranial nerve 1, which is going to be right in this region right here. Now, right in the middle of that, you have this projection referred to as the crista galli. And this is going to be the anterior connection of the falx cerebri, so that very dominant dural partition right in the middle of the two cerebral hemispheres. So that's going to be the anterior attachment of that. And that's all we really have in terms of this anterior cranial fossa. The more complex region is the middle cranial fossa. So intermediate, obviously. It's going to extend from the posterior border of this lesser wing of the sphenoid to the apex of the petrous portion of the temporal bone. Now, the petrous portion is probably the most dominant thing when you're looking at this view. It means rock-like or pyramid-shaped in this region. And we'll talk a lot more in detail about what's actually in there, but important in terms of your middle and inner ear. So let's start more anteriorly and we'll move posteriorly for the middle cranial fossa. Now this one is particularly difficult to see, but right underneath this lesser wing of the sphenoid is your superior orbital fissure. And we'll actually see this when you're looking into the orbit as well. So this large portion right here. So this is the connection between this, the internal portion of the skull to the orbit. So what type of nerves do you think are heading through there? Nerves that are going to play a role in terms of eye movement. So those extraocular eye muscles, the nerves that innervate that. So that would be oculomotor, which is cranial nerve 3, trochlear, cranial nerve 4, and abducens, cranial nerve 6. So all those three nerves are going to innervate those extraocular eye muscles. Additionally, also going through this region is what's referred to as the first division of the trigeminal nerve. So trigeminal nerve is cranial nerve 5. It is the largest of your cranial nerves. It's so large that it actually divides into three divisions that have their own names. So this is the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve. So it'll play a role in terms of sensory innervation of the sinuses. Right underneath it, you're going to have this very round foramen referred to as foramen rotundum. This is the second division of trigeminal nerve exits. So the maxillary division of the trigeminal nerve. So important in terms of innervating those front or top teeth, your maxillary teeth. And then lastly, you're going to have your foramen ovale right in this region, and that's the third division of your trigeminal nerve. So important in terms of the the muscles of mastication, so efferently providing innervation to those muscles of mastication. Now let's talk a little bit more about this petrous portion of the temporal bone. So very hard, very prominent in this region, and I think this is one of the neatest areas in the whole skeleton, because this is the only area where you have bone within bone. So if I were to crack open this region right here, you would have three of your tiniest bones, which are your ear ossicles. So your malleus, your incus, and your smallest bone, your stapes. Those are all going to be located in the middle ear, and that will lead into the inner ear. So very important in terms of hearing as well as equilibrium. So that is the middle cranial fossa in a nutshell. And let's focus lastly on this posterior cranial fossa. And as we discussed, this is going to be the deepest of your cranial fossa. You have your occipital lobe of the cerebrum sitting in here, as well as the cerebellum. Now, right in this region, on the opposite side of the petrous portion, you have your internal acoustic meatus. You have your facial nerve, or cranial nerve 7, which is going to enter through here, and it'll eventually exit the skull. Facial nerve is going to come up over and over again throughout our series, very important in terms of innervating those muscles of facial expression, so allowing us to smile or to wink our eyes, etc. Also, cranial nerve 8 is going to enter this region, but it's not actually ever going to exit the skull. Cranial nerve 8 is referred to as vestibulocochlear, and as its name would suggest, it plays a role in terms of hearing as well as equilibrium, so very important. Makes sense that it's going into this region and innervating that. Okay, continuing our discussion, probably another one of the most difficult of this to actually kind of show is your jugular foramen. And this is my favorite foramen of the body. There's a lot going on here. There's a lot exiting the skull in this region. You're going to have cranial nerves 9, glossopharyngeal, cranial nerve 10, vagus, and cranial nerve 11, accessory, all exiting the skull through here. So you have a lot in terms of cranial nerves, but importantly, those venous sinuses, those dural venous sinuses that are draining the brain, are going to coalesce right here to form the internal jugular vein. So if you've ever heard of cutting your jugulars, typically you're either talking about the external jugular or the deeper internal jugulars. So the internal jugular is going to begin on the other end of this region, so draining the entirety of the brain. Lastly, and probably the most dominant thing in this region, is the foramen magnum. This is the second largest foramen in the body. So even though it's called foramen magnum, it's actually not the largest. This is where the brain stem becomes the spinal cord. So on the inferior end of the foramen magnum, now we're talking spinal cord. Your accessory nerve, so cranial nerve 11 that we just discussed, actually ascends through the foramen magnum, and then it will go back through and descend through the jugular foramen in order to innervate your sternocleidomastoid muscles as well as your trapezius muscle.